Hey friends, we're glad that you're joining us on our YouTube channel. What you're about to see is a message from our Edge of Heaven series. We hope this is an encouragement to you today, and we invite you to share this video with your friends. If you haven't already, subscribe so you don't miss out on any videos that we upload. And if you're in the area, stop by on a Sunday. We'd love to meet you in person. Let's jump into God's Word.
Church. And we're so glad that you are here. We have kicked off a study on heaven, and we've been studying heaven starting last week. We're continuing that today, and I think it's really important that we take time to study heaven and this idea of heaven, because it can be a little bit overwhelming, and it can be intimidating at times if we're not careful, especially if you're new to following Jesus, or maybe you're in the room and you haven't even given your life to Jesus. It's kind of like, man, this, I don't know about the whole like afterlife, heaven, hell, like it all is just a little bit much for me. And so we have set out to take a few weeks and just try to understand what the Bible teaches us about heaven. There are some things that the Bible doesn't teach us and doesn't show us, and we just have to learn how to be okay with that, and we have to rest in that. And so, you know, with God, there is some mystery in following him. There is. There's just like some mystery that comes with following after God. And unfortunately, in our world, like it can be, that can scare us. It can create fear in us, and we have to learn to rest in the mystery of God. We have to learn how to just rest and know that in that mystery, there's blessing and there's provision and there's guidance as we trust in him. And so we're going to look at this study on heaven again, and there's really a couple of reasons why we're even doing this, okay? So first of all, the Bible tells us, it actually even commands us that we should be thinking about heaven. Like it should be on our minds. It should be in our perspective. And so many times we kind of ignore the idea of it, or we don't even think about it because it seems like it's a long way away, a long time from now, and we just don't fully understand it, and we kind of like what's going on in our life right now, right? Or maybe you don't like what's going on in your life, and so before you go to heaven, you want to change a few things, right? So it's just like somehow there's this mental block that can come, but yet the Bible tells us we should be thinking about heaven. We should be contemplating and processing the fact that this is our future. This is the preferred future God created for us. It is the blessing that he has promised to us. And so that's one of the reasons why we want to study heaven. But more than that, if we're not careful, the misconceptions about heaven can mess with our faith. They can cause us to get off track. We can lose sight of the real essence of the gospel and who Jesus is and what this life of faith is really supposed to be like. And so we have to be careful, because if we don't understand what the Bible says, then we can add things that maybe weren't in the Bible, or we can miss things that are in the Bible, and our misconceptions will misguide us. And so we've got to be cautious of that. So that's another reason why we study. And finally, we want to make sure that we understand and that we don't have a faulty view of why we're still on this earth. And so we want to make sure that we live on mission. Heaven is our future. Heaven is our home. If we say yes to Jesus and we give our life to Jesus, then we have a promise of heaven. We have a promise of eternity with him. And yet we're still on this earth, because we need to take as many people with us to heaven. Amen. We need to win as many people to Jesus and show as many. And so if we don't understand heaven, it's a lot harder for us to talk about the promise that God has for somebody else's life. It's a lot harder for us to look at our friends and our neighbors and say, man, God has a great promise for your future, an eternal promise for you, because we may not fully understand it or embrace it. And so we want to study this, so we can grab hold of the truth of it, and we can walk in the confidence, in the faith that God has given this promise to us. And so here's what I want to do today. I want to give you a scripture verse, and then I'm going to kind of just let that scripture just sit in your heart for a second, and we're going to deal with a couple of questions. And then at the end, we're going to circle back to that scripture, and we're kind of going to just see if we can tie it all together. And hopefully today we will learn a little bit more about Jesus. We will understand a little bit more about heaven. And I'm just trusting that God's going to do something profound in your life. John chapter 17, verse 24. It says this: Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, may be with me where I am. to see my glory that you have given me because you loved me before the foundation of the world. Father, I just pray today that you would speak to us. Our desire is to know you and to be with you. We want to see your glory, and we want to spend eternity with you. God, teach us about heaven today, for we long to be with you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Have you ever ruined a surprise? I have, all right? Like, maybe you haven't, but I'm the type of person, you can ask my wife, that I'm not good at receiving surprises into my life. Like, when she has really worked hard to try to surprise me over the course of the years, and I think she's done trying to surprise me because I just ruin it. I overanalyze things. I think too much about all of the details and things that are going to go into it. And so I end up, like what she works so hard to do to surprise me, I end up ruining it because I ask too many questions. Right? Like, I'm always wondering, like, okay, like, so when are we going, what are we going to do? Are we going to do this? Are we going to do that? What, you know, maybe we're doing this. How much money did you spend? Was it in the budget? Like, how, you know, like, I start asking all these things, which, by the way, she never stays in the budget, but that's a side point. We'll preach about that some other day. So I do this. It's crazy. Like, I can turn something fun into something overwhelming really quickly. Right? Like, it can just be super overwhelming and it gets me thinking about all of the things instead of just enjoying what it is she's doing to try to surprise me. And I work so hard to figure it out. And it got me thinking that maybe it's kind of that way sometimes in our relationship with God when it comes to heaven. Like, sometimes I just wonder if that's how it is in our understanding of heaven. That maybe we try so hard to figure it all out, and we take what's supposed to be fun and awesome and exciting, and it becomes overwhelming and daunting and scary because we don't know. And a lot of our fear comes from unknown. A lot of our fear comes from uncertainty. And so we work ourselves up and we get overwhelmed when God says, no, this is supposed to be awesome. This is a promise of blessing, and this is a good thing for your life. Despite all of the questions that you might have about heaven and what it's supposed to be like, it is the place where Jesus has said he wants to spend eternity with you. That's what's most important. It's most important to note that it is the place. You may have questions. You may ask all different sorts of things. You may research and look at articles and read and watch videos and all this stuff to try to figure out what heaven's going to be like and where it's located and who's going to be there. And we're going to deal with some of those questions. But at the end of the day, it is the place where he has said he wants to spend eternity with you. And that's good news. Where is heaven? Let's start there. Let's just tackle one of the questions that I'm sure maybe you've asked at some point in your life. I'm sure a lot of people have asked that, but where is heaven? The ATS Bible Dictionary tells us this: in this life, you can know but little of the location and appearance of heaven, or of the employments and the blessedness of its inhabitants. The scriptures inform us that all sin and every other evil are forever excluded. No fruits of sin will be found there. No curse, no sorrow, no sighing, no tear, no death. The former things are passed away. Amen. We may not know very much about the location physically of heaven from God's word, but there are a few things that we can be certain of. The first thing is that heaven is a real place. It's a real place. We can hold fast to the reality. The Bible teaches us that it is a real place. Now, there's always going to be a component of faith when it comes to God. Right? There's faith whenever you're trying to trust him to forgive your sins. There's faith whenever you're in need of a miracle and you have to trust him and put your faith in him. And there is faith when it comes to our understanding of heaven and the promise that he has given us of eternity. Hebrews 11:1 says, "Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see." It's our faith that gives us assurance of heaven. It's not because the Bible tells us every single aspect of heaven and what it's going to be like and where it's located and exactly how we're going to get there and blah, blah, blah. Like, there's not an exhaustive list. I wish there was just a chapter in the Bible called Heaven 101, but it's not there. There's a lot of great stuff about heaven, but Heaven 101 does not exist in this book. There is a component of faith that will create a confidence or an assurance in your life. Don't ruin the surprise. Look at your neighbor right now and say, don't ruin the surprise. What I'm saying to you this morning is that you're not going to be able to figure it all out. When we ask our questions, we may not always have the precise answer that we were looking for. But what I am saying is that there's a component of faith. When you follow Jesus, that mystery of Jesus creates this faith, and that faith is what creates an expectancy or a hope for that future. John 14, verse 1 says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled." Now, how many times have we let our hearts be troubled? I mean, how many times, like, this isn't just, oh, don't be in trouble or don't get in trouble, but this is don't let your hearts be troubled. How many times have we gotten ourselves to a point where we are troubled because we don't know what it's going to be like? We don't know what our future holds. We feel out of control. We feel out of the know. And because of that, we begin to fear instead of keep our faith strong in the reality of the promise. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. He didn't say, I'm going to prepare an idea for you. He said, I'm preparing a place for you. This scripture in and of itself gives us an indication that heaven is a real place, and that Jesus is preparing a place for you at that place. There is a place for you in heaven. He wants you there. He longs for you to be there. Heaven is a real place. Heaven is also the dwelling place of God. We know this. Scripture tells us this. Heaven is where God is. Think about that. Philippians 3:20, our citizenship is in heaven. It's not Chicagoland, it's not America, it's not whatever country you might have originated from. Our citizenship is in heaven. And we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. We see clearly that this is where Jesus is from. This is where God dwells. That heaven is where God is at. Psalm 33:13. It says this, "The Lord looks down from heaven and he sees all the children of man. From where he sits enthroned, he looks out on all the inhabitants of the earth." Heaven is a place where God can see and can monitor and can navigate the nuances of our world, because he's in control of the spiritual realm, which our mind can't even understand or comprehend. And so he's up there and he can see it all, and it expands. And he's got these angels and these armies, these different angelic beings for different purposes. And so he's got some that are there with him. And he's like, your goal and your job is to watch over this person. And you watch over that person. And you look over that person. And you get them out of trouble in those moments when they're about to harm themselves. And you watch over them in those moments when there's about to be an accident. And these angels are the army angels. And so if the enemy wants to mess with you, they're going through them. And then there's other ones, and they're just standing there, and they're just singing, and they're worshiping, and they're glorifying God. And God's up there orchestrating all of that. He sits on high. Heaven is upward. We may not know the exact geographic location, but we know that it is upward, and it's where God dwells. And quite frankly, all I need to know is that heaven is where God is. And where God is, that's where I want to be. The Bible talks about the fact that there's going to be a passing of the old heaven and the old earth, and there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. And honestly, for me, I'm like, that's great, as long as I can just keep being with God. Because to me, whether it's old heaven, new heaven, in between heaven, that's where heaven is, because God's there. I want to be with God. Revelation 21 gives us an incredible picture of heaven, talking about the new heaven and the new earth. I want to read just a couple of verses to you. It says this: "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as the bride adorned for her husband." Now check this out, verse 3. I love this verse. "And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God.'" Heaven is where God is. Heaven is the dwelling place of God. Heaven may not be as far away as we think. I know sometimes we get in our minds that, like, maybe it's this whole, like, Star Wars saga of, like, in a land, galaxy, far, far away was heaven, and I don't know how to get there. And, you know, but, like, we know that the kingdom of God is near. The Bible teaches us that the kingdom of God is near to us. And I believe both, maybe locationally, but also even in the time scale of things, the kingdom of God is near to us. But again, we have to be mindful that the Bible may not give us the exact pinpoint on a map location. There's an aspect of faith to understanding where heaven is. What is heaven like? The Bible Dictionary goes on to say this: "The scriptures describe heaven figuratively, crowding together all the images which nature or art can supply to illustrate its happiness. It is a kingdom, an inheritance. There are rivers of pleasure, trees of life, glorious light, rapturous songs, robes, crowns, feasting, mirth, treasures, triumphs. They also give us positive representations. The righteous dwell in the presence of God. They appear to Christ in glory. Heaven is life, everlasting life, glory, an eternal weight of glory, salvation, repose, peace, fullness of joy, the joy of the Lord." I love that we can go to the Bible to understand what heaven is going to be like. And not, we never want to discount, there's been so many times when people have had experiences, dreams, visions, things that have given them a glimpse maybe into what heaven is like, and we never want to pretend to rob somebody of what they might have experienced with God, because that's ultimately between them and God. And we don't, but what we do is we hinge our understanding and our faith off of the Word of God, not just off of things that people would say, not just off of articles, not just off of somebody else's dream, right? Like, we want to go to the Word of God, and the Word of God really clearly lays out some things about what heaven is going to be like. It's God's dwelling place, as we talked about. It's where Christ is today. Acts 1:11. It's where Christians go when they die. Philippians 1:21 through 23. The Father's house, John 14:2. It's a city designed and built by God, Hebrews 11:10. A better country, Hebrews 11:16. Paradise, Luke 23:43, streets of gold, gates of pearl, walls of precious jewels. In Revelation 21, as I just read to you, there's plenty that you can read in the Bible. As you open this and you begin to study what is heaven going to be like, there's a lot of visual understanding and representation that God's Word gives to us about the promised place. But let me caution you with this question, because so many times, if we're not careful, we ask what heaven will be like from a worldly perspective. Our intentions are good, but our perspective might be off, And we wonder, well, what kind of houses are they going to be? You know, like, are they going to be like farmhouses, beach houses? Like, everybody's heaven looks a little different in their minds, right? I want the beach house. Somebody want the cabin in the mountains. Does heaven have both? You know, like, we look at it from a worldly perspective. And we start trying to impose what we see in the world onto our understanding of heaven. When asking the question what heaven is going to be like, go to the scripture, read it, try to interpret it, try to understand it, but hold fast to the fact that more important than what it's going to be like, remember who you're going to be with. Amen. Remember who you're going to spend eternity with. Because quite frankly, who you spend eternity with is just, it's far going to outweigh anything that you're going to experience in heaven itself. Amen. The glory of the Lord is going to be with you. The joy of the Lord is going to be with you. It's going to be a sweet ceremony of rejoicing. Who is in heaven right now? Who is in heaven right now? Well, there's a couple of clear understandings in the scripture. God is in heaven right now. We just read that in Psalm 33:13. We read that it is his dwelling place. Jesus is in heaven. We saw that in Acts chapter 1. We see that Jesus, after dying on the cross, raising from the dead, he ascended into glory, he ascended into heaven, sitting down at the right hand of the Father. He's in heaven. There are angels in heaven, as I referred to earlier, Revelation chapter 8, Matthew chapter 25. There are angelic beings that are roaming heaven, and they're monitoring the earth and all of the beings in the earth and doing as God instructs them and guiding the things in the spiritual realm. There are saints in heaven. Those believers who have surrendered their life to Jesus, Old Testament, New Testament, today there are saints of God. There are people who have given their life to Jesus Christ, and then they have gone on from this life, passed on from this life, and they are in heaven. Hebrews chapter 12 says, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. If you read this passage of scripture, there are specific people that they mention from the Old Testament, but when you look at the understanding of that phrase, the surrounding of a great cloud of witnesses means that there's a vast expanse of people who are surrounding and in the glory room of God, just expressing worship. And so we understand from scripture that leaving this life, to be absent from the body, is to be present with the Lord. So there are saints, there are believers that are in heaven today. We have questions. We deal with questions, and it's not wrong to ask our questions. It's really not. I think that in asking questions, we dig deeper in our faith. We dig deeper in our understanding. So if you never ask questions, I'd caution you that maybe you need to grow a little bit. Maybe you need to push yourself a little bit. You need to press against the faith in your life a little bit to kind of fortify it, right? Because guess what? Growth happens in tension moments. So if there's no tension in what you believe and nobody's challenging your faith at all, you have no relationships and nothing that's pushing against that, then you may not be growing and strengthening your faith. So you want to grow that, and that's why you don't shy away from dealing with these things. Can I be the first one to say, I don't have a full enough grasp on heaven. I don't have a full enough grasp. One of my goals is to do a deep, in-depth study of the book of Revelation. I can't wait until I do that, and then maybe one day the Lord will give me the opportunity to share what I've studied, but like I've not spent the time like I could to understand that. But I press in these kind of moments because I know that it's not just gonna help you understand what the Bible says, it's gonna help me in my faith. Right? We've got to strengthen our faith and our understanding. But in the midst of all of our questions, all the things that we might have running in our mind, remember, heaven is the place where Jesus wants to be with you. John 17:24. Let's circle back. Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, may be with me where I am, to see my glory that you have given me because you loved me from before the foundation of the world. I love these words of Jesus because he's praying to the Father and he is asking for you who surrenders your life to Christ, you say yes to Jesus, he is pleading for the Father to bring you with him to heaven. He wants you in heaven because what happened before the foundation of the world, the glory of the Lord is something that we can't even wrap our minds around. I remember the moment that I walked up over the hill and I saw the Grand Canyon in person for the first time. I literally couldn't, in my mind like could not process it enough, and it looked like a painting. It literally, like, if you've never been there, I'm dead serious. You walk up to it and it's like, that's not real. There's no way. But if I walked off the edge, it would be real. That would be, you know, but like, it looks like it's not real. And so it's like almost like your mind can't comprehend it. And yet, Jesus is praying for us to be able to be with him so we can see the glory of the Lord before the foundation of the world. Anything in your life that you have seen that you thought, wow, that is amazing, is nothing in comparison to the eternal glory of God. Amen. What we will experience in heaven is, we can't even process. Yet Jesus prays, that they would just be with me. I want them to be with me because heaven is about being with our Savior. Heaven, in the midst of all of our questions, is a promise to spend forever in the presence of God. What does Jesus desire? For us to be with him forever. That we would just be with him. So many of us spend our life on this earth trying to impress him, trying to impress others, trying to accomplish a lot. But what is his desire? Just to be with him. That's his desire for you today, to be with him. So what do we do? What do we do with information about heaven? What do we do with what the Bible tells us? What do we do with what the Bible doesn't tell us? Well, we live by faith, not just by the facts. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. For we live by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. Where's your citizenship? Where's your home? Where do you belong? Heaven, not here. The kingdom of faith is your home country, Ephesians tells us. The kingdom of faith is where you belong. You have been given the right and the privilege and the honor of spending your eternity with God, the creator of the universe, your heavenly Father. Live by the facts. Don't live by things that you're trying to figure out every day. Live by faith. Because it's in that faith that you will get the assurance that you need. You'll get the hope that you need, the confidence that you need. I'm telling you, you won't get confidence from the facts. You won't be sure even if you try to answer every question in your mind. That's not where your assurance comes from. You can be sure when you just say, you know what, I'm going to rest in the mystery of God. I'm going to rest in the fact that he's promised this to me. And as Paul states in Philippians, for to live is Christ, but to die is gain. Right? Like, to live is Christ Jesus. To live is the strength of Jesus. It's the provision of Jesus. It's when I'm living, I know that I'm relying on him, and he's my strength and he's my source. And so to live means that I'm dependent on him. To live means that I'm in him. To live means that I can hope in him. But to die is even better, because I gain the promise that he has for me, and I gain the eternity that he has given me. It is rightly mine, and when I die, I win. What a win-win situation in the midst of a world that tells you that you might not be winning. Oh, but to trust in Jesus, you win. You know, some of you today, probably in this room, and you know, I bet some of you don't even believe in heaven. And that's okay, honestly. I mean, everybody's on this spectrum of understanding and belief and faith. And so some of you may sit here and you're just, I don't know. I don't know about the heaven and the hell and the afterlife. And, you know, it's a lot. It's a lot to take in. It's a lot to process. And you kind of just back away from it. Maybe you've said you don't believe in it. So others of you, you believe in it, but maybe you fear it because you don't understand it. You're afraid of the future. You're afraid of what might happen when you die. You're afraid what might happen if the rapture was to happen. And you worry, which is not from God. It's from your insecurity. Right? So like when you fear, when you worry, that's not God saying, here, I want you to worry about this, right? He doesn't impart that upon you. He wants you to trust him because he's promised you something great. Your insecurity oftentimes doubts that, right? And so wherever you're at in this room, wherever you are at in your understanding of heaven, you can be sure of this. Jesus Christ loves you, and he genuinely wants to be with you. Like, he's never going to get tired of being with you. He's never going to get tired or worn out by your personality. He's never going to be bothered by your questions. He's none of that. I'm telling you, we don't understand that as humans. We don't understand, because quite frankly, like, we get on our own nerves sometimes. But he's not going to get tired of you. He literally prepared a place to spend forever with you. And he just is asking you for your faith. Just for your faith. Can you trust him today? Maybe you've never put your trust in Jesus Christ. Maybe you've never surrendered your life to Jesus. And by surrender, I don't mean like you kind of did. I mean like you sold out. And you like said, this is all his. My life is in his hands. Maybe you've never done that before, and today could be your moment of saying yes to Jesus, saying yes to an eternity with him, and walking in a new confidence that you've never felt before. A confidence that when people look at you and say, why are you, like, why, what's different? Why are you confident? Why are you walking that way? You can look at them and say, Jesus. Like, oh, you're a church person, Sunday school answer, good job. I know, but like that's just it. Like, I don't know, it just works. Like, he just took my fear and bound it up and threw it away and gave me a hope. I mean, what if you could live in that kind of freedom today and all the way into eternity? Oh man, how sweet that would be. We live by faith, not just by the facts, because Jesus has called heaven your home, and it's the place that he wants to spend forever with you. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes with me? I just want to pray for you today. Thank you, Jesus, for your promise. God, I just thank you that we don't have to know everything, and that we can rest in the mystery of you. I thank you that we can live in your freedom and that we can be confident of what you have promised to give us, a citizenship, a home with you forever. God, it's not a place. We're not worried about where we're going. We're worried about who we're going to be with forever, and we want to be with you. Today, I just pray that you would ease the minds of your people amidst any questions that flood them. Let them rest, relax, and help them to step out into a new place of trust today.